I guess my first big question for you is, because this AFF at Home is really based on setting and, mm-hmm. you know, on story, we'd like to talk about all the things that are part of the writer's journey to making a great film. And what you did here was, like, you sort of took the My Dinner with Andre tact of, let's keep this in one space. We can mm-hmm. make the movie a certain way. I'm assuming, you know, that was part of your process. But you went to the dark side with it, for sure.
Right.
You know? So can you talk about, in particular, to begin with, what it was this, was this the first feature you wrote?
This was my first feature I'd written to direct. So that was the plan initially with Buried. I'd written a number of scripts prior to that. The plan with Buried was I was going to make it for about, I don't know, a couple grand. Uh-huh. Just make it on my own. And obviously, because you could pretty much shoot it anywhere. So, you know, just thankfully, it ended up taking on a much bigger and better life. And the movie turned out that 1,000 times better than had I directed it, especially at that point in my life. The weird thing about the script, though, was that I wrote a totally different script before what became Buried. In other words, I wrote another script about a person buried alive, the whole movie. Uh-huh. Totally different movie. It was more of a horror movie. And it at least told me it was possible. You know, at least by the end of writing that, I was like, actually, yeah, I did it. I actually wrote a movie with one person in a box for a whole movie. I had written a handful of scripts by that point. I had directed a few small projects. I didn't go to film school, so I was still very much learning. And I had written like mediocre stuff by that point. And I just got to the end of writing that version of Buried and it was mediocre again. And I was just kind of like, I mean, I could make it, but what, you know, not say what's the point of making it, but I want to move past mediocre. I don't think it's asking too much of yourself, you know, to not want to just be mediocre forever. So yeah, I mean, that was really it. I just had to be honest with myself and say, all right, this is just going to be mediocre at best. So after that, I just was willing to pretty much let go of everything, you know, other than the idea, like I said, that I knew it was possible to make a movie. As it was really just came down to the why, you know, why is this situation taking place? And the first version, again, as I said, was more of a like Jigsaw from the movie Saw. Like, I'm just doing this. I'm this crazy person. I'm doing this stuff to punish you. And it was more about finding the compelling reason why this is happening. And thankfully, I think I landed on it.
5 million money.
What?
5 million money tonight, 9 p.m. or Tuesday. Buried like dog.
$5 million from who?
Your family.
My family doesn't have $5 million. If they did, I wouldn't be here.
From embassy.
I don't know. Yeah. From the embassy. Yeah. Okay. If you let me out of here, they'll pay you the money. Yeah.
9 p.m. 5 million money.
How did you come upon that psychology of thinking about what would happen in here? You know, like, mm-hmm. that's a weird place to put yourself.
Certainly you play those, you know, those games of what would I be doing if this were actually happening to me? You know, and as for the journey the character goes on, there is kind of the element of, you know, the stages of grief almost, where it's, you know, it's denial and all the way down to acceptance. And that's, I didn't do that consciously, I shouldn't say I didn't do it subconsciously either. I wasn't setting out to say, all right, at this point, he's going to deny it and then so on and so forth. And this will be the transition point to the next step. But if I take a step back even further and just to say as a writer at that time, I mean, this was, you know, by this point, 11 years ago, 12 years ago, whatever it is that I wrote Buried. And, you know, I've been very fortunate to have a career since, but up until that point, I'd been trying to establish a career. You know, I'd been writing and writing and writing and really getting nowhere or not very far and kind of finding myself in a place where I think a lot of people do in our industry, where you question if it's, you know, time to throw in the towel. In a way, it was symbolic of kind of where I was in life at that time, because I felt trapped. I felt like I couldn't break out of where I was. And then I think also, and I don't mean to go off on too much of a tangent, it's just interesting now, perhaps, because I'm curious to see, you know, in the very, as every commercial will tell you, the unique circumstances we're in. I'm curious to see how that's reflected, because I think Buried for its time, you know, this is kind of around 2008 or so that I was writing it. Those sort of movies, that being one of them, this contained smaller movies or emblematic of what was going on at the times. I mean, this was during the financial crash. In a way, it just kind of spoke to that. And I mean, cinema tends to do that. I mean, whether directly or indirectly, is talking about what's going on in society.
Right.
For me, Buried was a reflection of that too, because it was a time where everyone was kind of constrained and boxed in and uncertain and afraid and all those things. And then just from the business side of it all, the timing was, I think, pretty good, because here was a movie that could be made for you know, a very small price, all things considered. Yeah.
So you put all these constraints on yourself as far as the script. I mean, you put the ultimate constraint on yourself. I mean, you can't get out of this freaking box, right?
Yeah.
What did that do for you from a story perspective as far as freeing you? I mean, was there freedom in having so much on your circumstances with this character?
I've kind of gone in a way full circle with the things I've written, because I started off as writing quite a few of these more, you know, contained movies, and then branched out to bigger and bigger stuff. And I just finished the script. Again, just like everybody else, I've had a project that was going to be directing in May, and it's been postponed indefinitely. I don't know when it's going to go now, but what I'm saying is it's getting back to this place of primarily seeing it through one person's lens, like Buried. And like Buried, like the script I just mentioned, I was able to blow through the script. I mean, I just burned through it in like, I think 17 days. I wrote this most recent one, and in Buried probably was about the same. I mean, you're servicing one character, essentially. And yes, you're hearing other people, and it's not to say they're not fully fleshed out characters. You certainly try to make them that, but you're not changing locations. It's just this from start to finish. And at the end of the day too, I mean, you shouldn't really overstay your welcome in a movie like that. I mean, you're not going to be writing a 120 page script. No. So
can you talk about a couple of scenes in there where you felt like, okay, that really worked well with this constraint?
Yeah. I mean, what was necessary was constantly changing the set as much as you can. You know, I mean, it's a guy in a box that's just slightly bigger than his body. So that that's your set in this case. I just felt the need visually to keep it interesting and changing and everything else, even on the page, never mind the amazing things I thought Rodrigo did. That meant including a lot of different lighting sources. So if you watch the film, there's times he has the Zippo, he has a flashlight. The flashlight then clicks to a red setting. But then there are the glow sticks and everything else. There's the blue from the phone. It's like there was, so visually there was a lot of changes to be made there. And then naturally bringing the outside world into this space when there's the bombing, for example. That's when all of a sudden the outside world has invaded his space, because the bombing cracks the wood. The wood now allows the sand to start pouring in.
The sand coming in and how it got used throughout.
Mm-hmm.
Almost feeling like, you know, that little thing that you use on the Boggle game.
Yeah, that's right. That was the idea. The hourglass feeling to it.
Yeah, I felt very much like, oh my, like this became this race.
Are you able to speak on the status of your situation?
It's worse. There's an explosion or something, and the sand's coming through. I probably have about half an hour before it's
slow down. You should try to stay calm. Now tell me something, Paul. Who have you spoken to?
There's a lot of pacing in here, considering the constriction.
While it was fast-paced, if it just was nonstop, just one pace, one speed the whole way through, it would have been diminishing returns at a certain point. You still have to provide those opportunities for things to slow down, for the audience to kind of catch their breath, mm-hmm. you know, so then you can grab them by the throat again. Because if you just grab them by the throat and hold them the whole time, and that's it, that's what they're feeling until they pass out. But I mean, giving them this false sense of like, oh, you're going to let me go. Oh, no, you're not. And on top of that, you're talking about, you were asked before about the collaboration with Rodrigo, with the director. That was something that even more so got put into play once he came on board, is that he wanted moments of levity beyond just moments of pressure release. He wanted to say, no, like, let's try, like, come up with a joke if he can, like something he can say here that might be a little funny. And, you know, and we kind of not battled, but I was like, I don't see him being funny in this circumstance. I can't see why humor would be coming into play. And he was confident. He's like, no, I'm telling you, he's like, it'll work. It'll work because it'll feel like gallows humor in the moment. It won't feel And I think he was right.
I mean, I found myself actually chuckling at his telephone conversations.
That's Paul Conroy. I'm a driver for you guys. I'm calling from Iraq. My convoy was attacked.
Sir, if this is a crisis situation, you need to contact the safety number you were
calling. I know. I don't have it anymore. It's the people took it.
Who took it, sir?
I don't know. The Iraqis, I think. I blacked out.
I'm going to put you through to Alan Davenport.
Who's that?
Director of Personnel. Please hold.
Personnel? No. Wait.
At CRT, we work with our clients to provide effective and sustainable solutions to the challenges they face in our fast-growing global economy. You've reached Alan Davenport, Personnel Director at Creston, Rowland & Thomas. Please leave your name and number at the tone, and I will return your call as soon as possible.
They're so relatable on just a normal, everyday level, how frustrating they are to be put on hold and listening and waiting and transferred around. And now imagine that when you're trying to save your own life and you're in a box.
It was interesting, too. I mean, this is just really an aside, but I mean, it just sort of felt after a while like the box became a bad guy, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Sort of, here you have this only person really there, but the box is kind of evil.
Certainly not cooperating.
it's not. And it became a really nice element of almost other character.
Mr. Mitchell?
Yeah. What do you want?
We spoke on the phone several times. I'm Dr. Turner.
Yeah. Well, nothing's changed.
I'm very sorry to hear that.
That's it, then.
Doesn't have to be this way.
Listen, you have no right to get involved. My wife is dying and
your wife is suffering. It's within your power to stop that.
You're not coming in.
Do it yourself, then. Any of you.
I told you before.
I've included instructions on how to operate.
We're not interested.
What about the rest of your family?
They're not either.
We're talking about your wife here, Mr. Mitchell. How can you not be interested? You have a safe and effective option available. Use it.
Your films ride this line, you know, between thriller and horror, it feels like to me. I mean, it seems like, you know, you have a lot of deliverance, mercy, you know, stuck in their own home, and then exploring, like, who's really the bad guy? I thought that was
right.
Really interesting perspective.
Right.
Can you talk about why you decided that was a story you needed to tell, and also, you know, putting them in this house where the house almost becomes their home, becomes their prison.
The story I thought would always, why it spoke to me and what I thought was interesting is that it really did play maybe too much with this notion of what it means to be a good person. You know what I mean? What it actually means, who are in real life, we're not just black and white. We're not just wonderful people or horrible, miserable people. We tend to kind of operate in the gray area. And that makes judgment tougher, you know, in real life than say, and typically does in movies, say who the good guys are and who the bad guys are.
Your mother got a lot of money when Travis and Brad's father died. A lot.
Yeah, Pop, we know. That's why we're here.
Shut up. Shut up. Now that money has been locked up in a separate account for years. And I made it so that when she passes, that money goes to me.
It certainly was the case in Mercy where these, you know, you kind of look at everyone involved in the situation and you kind of say, I know, I'm not sure who I'm rooting for here. And then maybe by the end, you realize, you know, maybe I was rooting for the wrong people.
We can't lose sight of what's going on here. We can't give up on Grace. Look, I didn't want this either. I was hoping we'd get in and get out without anybody getting hurt, especially not one of us. But that... it's not what happened. If anyone else wants to go, I understand.
What did you learn from that process of what you had scripted to what you actually had to transform onto film to actually make the audience feel that tension along with you, your writing?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, it was, I think, inherently kind of going to be able to bring out some degree of tension just by forcing people, especially people that there's this underlying conflict between them. if you're forcing them to be in this space together. It's something we see in a lot of movies where people get, you know, stuck during a snowstorm or whatever the case is. They can't leave. Now all of a sudden they are forced to confront whatever difficulties they might otherwise been able to kind of skate around. Even amongst family, when you have somewhat estranged family or, you know, difficulties amongst family members, it doesn't just become a knockdown drag out right away. It's not like I see you and now we're going to start screaming at each other. Sometimes it does, I guess, but you wouldn't be there together in the first place if you weren't at least willing to try. You know, we've all been there. It's like, oh, you go to see certain relatives and it's like, I'll do it. We'll be fine. You know, we'll get through it. It's fine. But now all of a sudden when you can't leave and this is lasting far longer than you hoped it might, and people are starting to let go a little bit, you know, and the digs are coming and one leads to the next. And that's what I wanted to bring out. I wanted to bring out this thing thread by thread by thread, starting to see the acrimony and the underlying strife that exists in this family. And as we, as an audience, are trying to figure out why. Like, what is going on here? A, why do these people just dislike each other so much? What is it about their family dynamic? And then the larger thing is like, what is going on in this movie?
So I want to talk about Sea of Trees because you brought mm-hmm. that up, and I'm sure it was an interesting experience working with Gus Van Sant. How did that take hold in your brain where you realized this is a script I want to do? And
the idea entirely came from the setting itself. I learned about that forest, which is a real place in Japan. And I thought it was, you know, maybe fascinating isn't the right word, but for lack of a better one, I thought it was. And, you know, I thought it was that people, not just from Japan, although that represents a lot of people that go there to commit suicide, people from around the world go there to commit suicide. And I don't know, it seems so sad to me, just so sad that people would be so far gone by that point, that they would travel thousands of miles to this place. And even along the way, as they're interacting with people, I mean, you have to talk to people to travel. None of that really was enough. Like that wasn't enough life to keep them from wanting to be part of life.
Go. Please take a ticket.
Arthur Brennan.
Okay. Where will you be traveling to, Mr. Brennan?
Tokyo.
My first inclination, because I had done some horror stuff, I was like, well, that's, you know, a really cool place setting for a horror movie. And then one subsequently came out, a horror movie called The Forest. But I didn't want to do a horror movie there. I wanted to do something different. And, you know, something that spoke to that element of sadness and tragedy and spirituality in its own way. From a career standpoint too, I mean, I spoke earlier about having done a couple of these very small contained thrillers. I think early on in your career, it certainly doesn't hurt to have a thing that you're known for. In my case, I was the contained thriller guy, you know, so it was great because, you know, when you're just starting out, you really want to find some work and find opportunities and everything else. And so in that regard, it was great. But then after a certain point, it becomes a bit of a hindrance because then you kind of want to branch out. You kind of want to be known for more than just that. And I certainly did. So that was the other impetus for Sea of Trees, was that for me, I wanted to show that A, I could write things other than thrillers and horror scripts. And I also wanted to write something that took place on a bigger canvas. So even though that is, you know, it's still a fairly small cast, uh-huh. but it's taking place in a much bigger location and more going on. And, you know, it's certainly not a guy in a box. Let's put it that way.
Yeah. But it did have a lot of what I would say are some of your signature elements. You know, I mean, it's definitely that exploration. That forest becomes such a part of the film. It's a character in the film.
Yeah.
I really love the juxtaposition of getting the flashbacks to mm-hmm. that life woven into the story. I'm curious if that's how you wrote it or if that was a director's decision, but like the way those were woven in, I thought was really wonderful. I mean, it really let me learn who this man was, mm-hmm. what was so weighing on him that would make, that would put him in a position to make this decision like you're talking about, you know, to go to a place like that.
No one entered the forest that day.
It is during our darkest times that our loved ones are closest, even those who have passed.
Promise me you'll find the perfect place.
It is said a flower grows when a soul has crossed over from this place.
The flashbacks, that was scripted that way. I would say it was very, the movie ultimately was very faithful to the script, which is, you know, obviously it's great as a writer. That's kind of what you always hope for. It doesn't always turn out that way, but that's what you always hope for. I mean, Gus was fantastic. I mean, he's as great as he is for a reason. No, but I learned a lot, and I learned from him. I mean, that's the thing too. You know, I was talking before about directing and going on my own directing journey. I've been learning along the way and learning from people that I've been fortunate enough as a writer to kind of be working alongside. And seeing how they're taking the material I wrote, and kind of transmuting it, I guess, into this visual format. And so I learned a lot from Gus.
I saw Greenland. I saw the director's cut, by the way.
Oh, nice.
Really loved it.
Thank you.
Anxious for it to actually come out in the movie theater.
Yeah, me too.
How was it writing something that was much more truly an action film, you know, with a action star?
Well, and on top of it, like, it's such a departure, you know, since we keep going back to Buried. I mean, it's such a departure from that because it is massive in scope. I think ultimately this is what I said before about square footage not really dictating story. I mean, we're still, the more characters resonate with us and the more we can put ourselves in their shoes and the more we feel for them and the troubles and obstacles they're up against. That's kind of always my goal, even with something big, is it to make it feel very personal. It makes it easier, I think, if you're talking about regular people, for an audience to be able to kind of see themselves in characters. But even if you're talking about heightened characters, superheroes, let's say, I think you'd still do well to make these characters resonate with your audience in a way that there's whatever, pathos, whatever it is. There's just something about them that feels very real. And that's, I guess, what I try to do with any of the things I write, is to have at its core a very personal story, you know, a very personal goal that the main character in particular is after.
Bill Whitliff was a screenwriter who was very involved with us. And one of the things he used to talk about with developing story is sometimes he would realize all these characters, how are they individualized? And mm-hmm. he said, sometimes I would just put them in a car, drive them off a cliff and see if they live, you know, and yeah. Did they deserve to live? Did they really have a place in here? Were they different than somebody else? Should that really be, you know, melded into a different character to get me where I need to go? Yours seem to be put into these places where you can really explore fully what somebody could or would be. We've been talking about setting, but from the character perspective, you know, what has that done for your ability to really develop these they're very developed. I found in Buried, he was a very developed character to me, you know?
Yeah. I mean, I think that analogy that you just mentioned about driving characters off a cliff is a great one. And I'm sure I'll steal it because it's awesome. That's it more than anything, is if you don't care as an audience member about what's going on, but even more so, if you don't care about people in success and in failure, that's my goal all the time. And I think if it's just a bunch of explosions and if it's just a bunch of people that we don't care about, if there are no stakes, we don't care about the conflict. A lot of the things I've done, and honestly, I didn't realize this until you kind of pointed it out a second ago, is characters are kind of starting from a fairly low place. You know, they're not characters that their lives are going great. And then something bad happens. Usually it's, you know, like the guy in Greenland. Again, he had some work to do, right? He's a guy that needed a redemption. Whether he deserved it remains to be seen. Even with Paul and Paul Conroy in Buried, it's like this guy, he's someone that has flaws. And we come to understand what those flaws are. We get a sense of who he is. And then we as an audience can decide, yeah, this is someone I want to see get through this. If we don't attach ourselves emotionally, just being intellectually attached, if you will, I don't know if that's enough. I don't know if that makes us care enough.
I really liked those characters, not just because it was Gerard Butler and he's hot, you know. It was because he was somebody I really wanted to see things work out for him. It was like, yeah. were really, these people were struggling and trying. And I think that character development thrown up against this constraints that these people have is just really interesting to me. It's a really great way to get to know somebody. So I think you've done it incredibly successfully. So just on IMDb, what your newest film is showing up there in pre-production. And I don't know if that's the one you're talking about directing, but it was something like 495.
Oh yeah, Incident on 459. Yeah, that was again, so much has happened in like the past, you know, month or two. Things have changed so fast. That is another contained thriller because I wrote it during that time, like that post-buried time. That all takes place on an airplane with people are stuck on board a transatlantic flight with a woman who's possessed. We have a plane set built in Ukraine currently, and I have no idea what's going to come with that movie now.
So what's the one
Oh, so yeah, that wasn't the one I was talking about. The one I was talking about is a movie called Lakewood that I did. Again, we were set to go out and make the movie in, you know, early summer, essentially. So I don't know. I don't know. It's the unprecedented times that we were talking about.
But this should be great breeding ground for you.
It's actually been tougher. I found myself getting far less done.
Why am I writing this movie? Nobody's ever going to make it. There's no.
Well, there's that. That's actually, I said that very thing to my wife earlier today. And she, you know, I was like, you know, there are certainly projects. Thankfully, there is still development going on and I'm pitching on things and that stuff feels real. At what point the process will stop, though, I don't know. And especially when it comes to, say, my own material, generating new things where I'm kind of like, usually there's, even if it's a hope that this, you know, will go on to actually get made or become something, it's always a hope. But now there's even more uncertainty built in. So it doesn't exactly create this fire for you to be like, oh, I've been dying to write this idea. Now I have the time to do it.
I've heard that from a lot of people. I'm sure you talk to a lot of writers, but I've heard it from a number of writers. I've heard it from musicians. I've heard it from, they're all having a really hard time, kind of people who live in this world anyway, you know, home all the time. So what's different, right?
Right, so, right.
The rest of us that are, it's really a really interesting thing that's happening.
Also, I think, you know, this is kind of what I was saying earlier on with how with Buried, I wrote it at a time, it was pretty much in the midst of the financial crisis. And how does this find its way directly or indirectly into people's movies? I mean, how do you have movies that don't, if you want them to be very grounded, taking place in the real world sort of movies, how does this influence narratives now? Yeah. You know, and I wonder if there's some version of movies that are going to be much more viable.
Yeah.
And I don't know if it's just because cheaper to make or require fewer locations or fewer people or...
We're talking about it that way. Like in the beginning, as it sputters back, you know, there will be the constraints of that. The next, you know, the next 2 years, I think are going to be a very interesting time to see how things, you know, wash through. Well, this was really great. I'm glad you were going crazy and that we got access to do this. And you made me go to a very uncomfortable place and watch your movie. But now I can say I made it through, but I really ended up, I was so glad to go watch Sea of Trees because I really enjoyed it. I really enjoyed it.
Thank you.
Yeah, it was wonderful. And I really can't wait for Greenland to come out. I'm excited for you now. And I was excited for Rick. I really liked the way the movie turned out. So.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. Hopefully, you know, 2020. Thank you.